So we collected scientific literature and grey literature for four topics. And one topic is active transport. One was more on sustainable food consumption. The other one was more about how could we can we promote green spaces in cities. And finally, there was one on energy efficiency. So those were the four topics we looked into in more depth. And for those four topics, we looked at present and current developments, what impacts, what are the exposures, what are the health impacts that we can expect, and what are the issues with regarding with inequalities, are certain groups more exposed or not? And finally, what interventions are already there that we can think of to improve the situation? And we did this with two things in the back of our mind. One was we want to work on a triple win. That was the basic idea for Inherit, that we look for those interventions that are good for the environment, that are sustainable, interventions that promote health, and also interventions that make sure that the gap between certain groups is diminished, because we see within Europe big differences in health situations between different socioeconomic groups. So that was the triple win: promoting environment, health, and equity. And the other thing we looked at in the baseline review is we took the model, the Inherit model that we developed, and their behavior was central in it. And we evaluated all interventions for the four topics for their behavior aspects. So we looked at capability and opportunity and motivation. The general conclusions of this baseline review, the first conclusion was we need to do something now. We need to act now. If we look at the drivers of exposures in Europe, for example, in the area of transport, we see that we still the numbers of car use is rising in Europe, and transport, for example, is one of the sectors where CO2 emissions are not declining. So for Europe as a whole, we need to do something now. Because if we look at the patterns of production and consumption in Europe as a whole, we have unsustainable lifestyles and we have unhealthy lifestyles. And in order to change that, we need to tackle the main drivers behind that. But that's also a complex issue, because if you take the whole food system, it's a very complex chain from source to what's in the end is in our plane on our plate. So if you want to change that, you need a more systemic way of looking at the problem. And that also means that we have to look at it together with all the important sectors involved in these processes. So we do not only need to act now, but we also need to do it together with all the important stakeholders involved in these processes. So we do not only need to act now, we also need to do it together with all the important sectors that, for example, are involved in the food system. So it's not only the agricultural sector, but it's also the retail and the supermarkets that all are influencing the way how we eat and consume. So we also looked at what are the most effective interventions and policies in a general way for all the four topics. And a general conclusion is that it's very effective if we combine structural measures with behavioral measures. And with structural measures, we mean measures, for example, the development of safe and attractive walking and cycling routes in order to promote people to be more active. And another example of structural measure is, for example, the introduction of food taxes, for example, a sugar tax, which makes drinks that contain a lot of sugar more expensive. So those are examples of structural measures. But they are more effective if you really want to make a change, if you also combine them with behavioral measures. And usually those are measures that are really aimed at nudging people in a certain direction. So it's not that you're punishing people. Taxes actually are a little bit punishing, but that you really encourage people to make a change. So, and usually examples of that type of measures are financial incentives or incentives to make the healthy choice or the sustainable choice the more easy choice. So those are examples of behavioral measures. So it's the combination of structural and behavioral measures, and it's also if we look at the type of initiatives and the stakeholders behind it, the combination of top-down measures that are really at national level or regional level, combined with bottom-up initiatives. And that's what Inherent really did. We looked for at a lot of bottom-up, at real more local initiatives. Regarding the issue of citizen engagement and the issue of inequity, for example, we looked at interventions for energy efficiency and energy transition. And there we see that low-income groups are very concerned because they don't have the money really to make their houses climate-proof or to change to another system of energy sources in their house. So if governments really want to make this energy transition happen, which we have to do, because otherwise within a couple of years, we have plus 4 degrees extra temperature here in Europe. So if we want to prevent that and we really want to make this energy transition happen, we have to take into account these low income groups, because they have much other worries to deal with than changing their heating system in their houses. And what the analysis of the baseline review showed, that if you take these groups into account and if you show them and if you engage them and look for opportunities how maybe energy transition can help them in saving energy and saving money, that might be like an incentive for them to also look at these issues. And another lesson learned, that if we really want to have changes happen, then we need not only to engage citizens, but we also need to engage businesses and private companies. I think a lot of businesses are already moving towards the direction of more sustainable production, but health is not always in the forefront of their minds, so they could work a little bit more on that. But of course, they also we need to think of new business models, so that in order to incorporate all these changes and more sustainable and healthy interventions, how can it be interesting for businesses? So actually, we need to have more information on what the costs and benefits are for certain interventions. And the baseline review gave some examples. For example, in the area of active transport, a lot of money can be saved there in getting the people out of the car and getting them more active on their bicycle or simply walking to work or school. But that's on the cost benefits, but we also need to have more guidelines on how private companies can work together with policymakers and with citizens in order to come up with better approaches and better systems. And one example is, which is an example which is, by the way, not in the baseline review, is, but yesterday I talked with the head of a very big Dutch supermarket, and what they are thinking of, because they have a lot of shops in different cities in the Netherlands, and supermarkets are producing a lot of heat, literally producing a lot of heat and CO2. And they're thinking of systems, how they can use, well, the emissions from the supermarkets to heat the houses of the people living around the supermarkets. So these are type of new approaches that can help us in the end in reaching these more sustainable and healthy environments. So what we did is we looked at the behavioral aspects of interventions in four topics. And for example, in the topic of active transport, we looked at, okay, what are interventions that look at stimulating either capability, opportunity, or motivation. For active transport, which actually we define as walking and cycling to and from work or school or shops, but also the walking and cycling to and from public transport. We call that active transport together. And if you look European-wide, there is a lot of to be gained if we make this shift, if people really leave the car at home and take the bicycle. But it's also not very easy, because in a lot of countries the infrastructure is not there or not safe enough. In London we have too much cycling fatalities, for example. So if you want to make this shift from car use to more active transport, at first you have to work on this, what we've, according to this behavior model, called opportunity. You have to make the environment more inducive, for more attractive for cycling and walking. So these were the general conclusions, but we looked more in depth at four topics. And if you take, for example, the topic of active transport, we see that there's a big opportunity there if we move from car use to more active transport. And I'll explain a little bit why. First, we see that a lot of car journeys in Europe are less than 5 kilometers. So that's not much of a distance that you really can cover either by public transport or by cycle or by walking. And that's also the way how we define active transport. That's cycling, walking to school, to work, or to and from public transport. So if we could really replace these short car trips by cycling or walking, that would mean a huge benefit. That would mean a huge benefit for health, because if people are more physical active, it's better. You have less cardiovascular diseases. It's better for your mental health, and it prevents all kind of other problems. But it's also, of course, good for the air quality, good for you have less CO2 emissions. That means if we really replace car trips by cycling. And finally, it's also it's something that everybody can afford, even if you have a low income. So if we can really reduce the number of cars in our cities, we'll get more space in our cities, because cars take up a lot of parking space, and of course cars also cause a lot of traffic jams in our cities. So if we can replace that by other means of transport, that will be very advantageous. So these are the the positive aspects if we make this shift from car use to active transport. Mm-hmm. But now the big question is, how are we really going to do that? And if we take the approach using the inherent model and the behavioral model, there are certain lessons learned that first, you really have to work at opportunity at the environment. You have to provide safe, preferably separate, cycling and walking routes. And with separate, I mean separate from the main highway or main road. So safe routes. We also have to do something about the perception, because we find in our research that people often think that a certain route is not safe, while actually nothing ever happens. But because we think it's not safe, we use our cars, for example, to bring the children to school. And in the end, we are with too many cars bringing the children to school, which makes it unsafe. So we also need to do something about the safety perception of people and encourage people to, for example, bring the children to school by their own means, by walking, cycling, and not by by using a car. And also we need a dense public transport system, because not everybody is capable of cycling or walking. For example, elderly or handicapped people, you still want to have provide the same opportunity for them to move around. So safe routes, safe cycling, walking routes, and a dense public transport system. That's the opportunity part. But we should not forget the capability part. Actually, in the Netherlands, we forgot that, because we thought here everybody can cycle. But now we see that in the inner cities in the inner part of big cities, that there are children that cannot cycle. And the reason behind that is, first, one of the reasons I just talked to you about is that people think, okay, it's unsafe, we're not going to put you on a bicycle. And there are also groups that think it's too expensive to buy a bicycle. So I have one nice example in Rotterdam, where a school started to work together with parents and with people in the surroundings. And they talked to parents, okay, what can we do to stimulate children to take the bicycle to school? And one part what they did is they gave BMX lessons to show children, okay, it's fun to cycle. They talked to parents about safe routes to school. They invited an elderly guy living in an environment who gave the children bicycle maintenance lessons. And all this helped in that within 1 year, 25% more children cycled to school instead of taking the car. So this is a little example that even in a country where a lot of people cycle already, you still can need to think about this capability part, and need to think of, okay, can people cycle, and do they think it's safe enough to cycle? And also, of course, you have to work on the motivation part, the M part of the combi model. And in this case, the school example, that was why they invited this BMX popular guy to give these lessons, and that children think, okay, it's cool to cycle. It's not only cool to take my scooter or my motor, but it's also cool to cycle. So, and finally, we also have to work on the M part of the comp model. So we have to think about how to keep people motivating for cycling or walking. So, that was the reason why in the Rotterdam example, they invited this BMX person who was quite famous locally to give these lessons to make children aware of, okay, cycling can also be cool and fun. So that's important for children, but also in the Netherlands, we have also a special program for elderly people. And finally, one of the other aspects, if you want to influence the motivation of people to shift their behavior towards more active behavior, then it's also very important to know the culture values of the groups that you are addressing. So for certain groups, it's much more important, you have a much higher status if you own this very expensive and sleek car instead of maybe having a bicycle. So you have to take that into account. So the lessons learned are, from one, make it fun, take into account the culture values, think of the perceived safety that people have in their minds, and think of nice incentives. So if you want to convince employees to take the bicycle to work instead of the car, so to summarize, the conditions for success in order to really make this shift from car use to active transport, we have to work on the capability. There's, for example, the cycling lessons. We have to work on the opportunities, so provide safe cycling routes, but also a good public transport network. And you have to think of to work on the motivation of people, and you can do that by incentives, by making it fun, but also it's very important to look at the culture values of the groups that you are addressing. So you need this combination of, like I said before, structural measures and behavioral measures, and that means that you have to work together with different groups, because the people that are developing the cycle highways or the cycle paths are not the same ones as the people who are at local level working at schools. So, and actually that's an important recommendation for all the INHERIT work, that in order to make this more sustainable change, different sectors, the environmental sector, in this case the transport sector and the health sector, but also private companies have to work together to make this really happen.